It's an enormously important meeting for us at the UCL Institute for Sustainable Resources, this one, because we're talking to CDP about partnership of various kinds. And so I'm going to be absolutely fascinated to hear what Patrick has to say and this utterly intriguing title of his talk, Solving the Problem of Climate Change, just a small problem, as we're aware, through CDP and the Ideal University, by which he must mean UCL. He was quite enigmatic about that when I put it to him before we started. I'm Paul Eakins, I'm Director of the Institute of Sustainable Resources, so it's my great pleasure to welcome you and him here. I always forget the domestic arrangements. Should there be a fire alarm, I'm not expecting one, please make your way through various fire exits, one there and one out there, and go out into Tavistock Square. Patrick is responsible for CDP's engagement program. CDP used to stand for the Carbon Disclosure Project, but like so many organizations, I think it's purely acronym-based now, and has the relationship with global environmental NGOs, such as, more acronyms, GRI, WRI, IIRC, there you go. He's had a fascinating career, head of business development at the UK's Telegraph Media Group, trustee of Telegraph Staff Pension Plan, from which you probably gather that business training, MBA from London Business School, and then the MSc in Responsibility of Business Practice from Bath University, where I've lectured once or twice. I didn't know whether I was a lecturer there or you were on that course. He lives within the South Downs National Park, and is no doubt looking forward to fracking, but we'll be going on there reasonably soon. And in his spare time, he's a founding director of the Lewis Pound, the local currency for Lewis, which is also fascinating. I think I was responsible for introducing local currencies to this country in 1985. So we have lots of points of contact. He's clearly something of a wizzo with new technology, having done work with Accenture, Microsoft, and SAP with the upgrade of the CDP systems. You're very welcome, Patrick. Much looking forward to what you've got to say. Normal format, talk for 30, 40 minutes, then we'll have some questions, and then we'll go upstairs and have some questions.
Well, good afternoon on this warm evening, and thank you very much for the introduction. I believe that climate change is one of the greatest puzzles we've got, but I do believe it's solvable. And a combination of CDP, which I'll explain a bit more in detail later, and the Ideal University will set the context for the change that's needed. But there's no doubt that it's a challenge. So I'm going to introduce climate change and some of the issues that most of you will be familiar to most of you, but you'll understand some of the complexity and the detail of it. Look at CDP as the catalyst, and really some of you will be very familiar with it and others may not, so it is an introduction. And some of the initiatives that CDP are doing ourselves and with partners to try and move together towards a solution to these issues. We realise that we can't do this ourselves, it's not one of those problems. And therefore I'm going to look at the Ideal University. And that's not to spare people's blushes, but it's just it was a very good suggestion that somebody had to call it the Ideal, to say, just imagine what we could do if this Ideal University could be replicated all around the world. But there's some issues with it that'll come along to it, and some fundamental ones which to do with communication and coordination, but we'll come on to that later on. And I want to then end up talking about what I think is a necessary solution to climate change. You'll know it's not a sufficient solution, but it's a necessary solution to set the context to move on. So in 1987, the world was threatened by ozone holes and CFCs, And I just want to quote from Kofi Annan, who said, perhaps the single most successful international agreement to date has been the Montreal Protocol. And that was where the governments of the world got together to solve this problem. And by 2050, they reckon that the ozone layer will have healed and will be back to 1980 levels. Now, climate change is different. We know that there are multiple causes of climate change. Some of the old ones, you know, emissions, refrigerants, land use, deforestation. And even today, at the weekend, a friend of mine was talking about, do you realise what's happening in the tundra, the amount of methane that's being released because of global warming, is going to put man-made emissions to be a fraction of all that. That may or may not be so, but the point is that there are multiple causes. Multiple impacts, deforestation, droughts, extreme weather, and regulation amongst others. Economics, global economics, national, local, and individual. And that's before you get into global inequality and justice to try to balance what's going on in the developed world, developing worlds, and between countries. And then you've got future generations. And there are very few students here, but I've done some talks at Oxford and Imperial, and particularly undergraduates, the anger that these guys have got, they want their voice heard, and we are duty bound to start considering future generations. If we don't get this right, adaptation becomes a real issue, not only the problem of adapting to climate change, but also the relief mechanism that we need when we don't. So how on earth are we going to solve all this? I was really intrigued about communication in 2006 Al Gore's film, An Inconvenient Truth. And then when I was doing this talk, I noticed a strapline, and it's called A Global Warning. And I sometimes wonder when we talk about change, when we just see the magnitude of change, and sometimes it's not logic that will drive change. And I just said to myself, if I talk about global warming of 2 degrees, I look outside, time for the pub, it's all quite nice really, what's the problem? If I talk about a global warming of 2 degrees, suddenly there's a little bit of a shiver there, and the lights go off, and carry on. But just that little subtle change can be enough to make a change. So change doesn't have to be with a big stick, it can be subtle changes. And we're going to need all these tools at our disposal when we move forward. Another little change, and I was shocked when I heard that the Australian weather maps had to have a new colour code because of the weather. Now obviously we're talking about climate rather than weather, but even that is something. And it had to be the Guardian that said it called it an incandescent purple. So you know, even they get the point there. Those are all sort of nice fluffy things, as important as they are, but we then had 2006 for Stern Review. Now this was mainstream corporate political Britain, and this was for the Prime Minister and the Chancellor of the Exchequer. So this wasn't about fluffy koala bears and what's happened to them. This was about the economics of, based on the science from the IPCC reports and what's happening. And the interesting thing about this is that we can take action now, and it may cost, but it won't cost nearly as much as it will cost in the future. There's still time to avoid the worst impacts of climate change if we take strong action now. And we can debate long and hard whether we are taking strong enough action. And that's one of the reasons for CDP, which we'll come on to. CDP acts as a catalyst, and it's by making business respond that we believe that climate change can be seen and become a transparent issue. So transparency is a key theme for what we're trying to do. Our vision is a global economic system that operates within sustainable environmental boundaries and prevents dangerous climate change. There's nothing revolutionary there, I hear you say. But what is revolutionary is that it has to be said, because we are against environmental boundaries. We have got evidence of climate change now. And the mission of CDP is to put relevant information at the part of business, investment and policy decisions. So that, in a nutshell, is what we're trying to do. A complicated slide, but I'll try and simplify this. Because I don't plan to get into detail, I'm just trying to set the scene and set a context before trying to see how we can come together with universities and with the rest of the world and how we can create the communication and connections. CDP acts on the authority of investors. And at the moment we've got 95 trillion dollars assets under management. I don't know what a trillion is, but I know that's over a third of the world's invested capital that these people want information about climate change. And what we do is, on their behalf, we ask the listed companies around the world to about the business response to climate change, what they're doing about it. So this saves a lot of time for the university. So rather than each individual investor having to say to each individual company, give me a report in this format or that format, we provide the gold standard of reporting to enable each business to respond at once through to the investors. Now, that model we've applied to the water program and the forest program. And so if you hold on to that, the same model of authority we applied to our supply chain program. Our supply chain program has got 75 businesses, Walmart and Unilever, this world, and again on their behalf, we go to their suppliers. Not all of their suppliers, but just some of their suppliers that they request. So we're working on their behalf. And again, a single response, and it might be the same response that the company has been given to investors. So Unilever, for instance, will have responded to the CDP program to investors, and that same information will form the basis of the supply chain. So again, we're trying to reduce our reporting burden, provide consistency and transparency to the rest of the world. And what's interesting is that over 80% of the global 500 businesses disclose to us. And at the last count, 60% of businesses by market cap in the world respond through this process. And it is a process. What's interesting here on this graph is to show the interest from 2003, that was before the Stern Review, how there's been an increase when we launched all the way up to the figures that we're talking about now. And you'll see when water started in 2010, how dramatically that rose up the agenda. And we've got forests as well. So just some figures for you. So about 5,000 companies responded to CDP in 2004 to the supply chain program and the investment and climate change program. Over 1,000 to the water program, and 100, almost 200 to the forests. So, this is a nice quote, but really, by asking strategic questions, we enable the CDP process to shine a light on what's happening in these corporations. And it's nice to have an endorsement from someone who knows about climate change. And a little bit in practice, and again, I feel when I'm repeating myself, we've got the shareholder information request, the data that gives the gold standard for climate change reporting, and by that I mean that we can provide consistency, comparency, and transparency, along with the insights of what's actually happening in businesses. And what's interesting for me is when you get into the detail, is these are the questions we ask. And somebody credited CDP with bringing nature into the boardroom. And the reason for that is that most regulations talk about emissions. And emissions more often than not go straight to the operations department, or the accounts department, and they cancel up doing the calculations and come back. As soon as you ask about management and the governance and the strategy and the targets and what they're doing about it, their emission reduction activities, it has to go right the way through the organisation and then has to be signed off by the senior management. And once you start looking at risks and opportunities, you're putting a real pebble in the shoe of these guys to say, what does this mean to us? Because my shareholders, the people who own my company, are asking about these questions. And then the important stuff, the quantitative stuff, about the emissions to make certain the methodology is right, the data is right, and all the different scopes are coherent and actually relevant to the questions that can be used. And finally, no one else is really providing this information on this format. And again, it's nice to have the fact of really talking about this. And you talk about the success of global business in the 21st century. And that's what we're all trying to do. And you'll notice the CDP strapline is driving sustainable economies. Now, that may be a grand thing, but that's what we're trying to do, and sustainable meaning for the long term. I'm going to briefly introduce the CDP programs. The first one is the supply chain. And what's interesting about the supply chain is that Walmart took a few years to respond to the climate change survey in the CDP. The reason for that is that they knew where their emissions were. It was in their trucking fleet, obviously. And it was only when they actually did their response that they found that the majority of their emissions were from their refrigerants. And that's why a light went on within Walmart, that huge operation around the world, said that we don't know what's happening in our own organisation. How on earth can we know what's happening in our supply chain, which is the future of the business? And from that, we worked closely with them to set up the supply chain programme, where we got 75 members with the asking 7,800 companies to disclose through the CDP process. So, interesting about the supply chain, it is about their emissions, but it's also about the risks. And this was back in 2012, the Thailand floods. And what was interesting was that Intel had to reforecast by $1 billion, their revenue forecast. Honda went on to a 3-day week. And I needed a new hard disk drive, and I had to pay three times as much as I would have done before that. So it's all relevant stuff. The CDP Water Programme is a critical business issue. And what we have done working with the UN Global Compact and the CEO Water Mandate is we are promoting water stewardship. And we've got these questions, they're becoming standard. We've introduced these questions to become standards for companies to ask the right questions internally. And from that greater transparency, that facilitates the informed decision making within the business as much as within investors. So yes, we encourage action to stop the water risk, and also it is about governance and stewardship of those issues. And we know that water is a tricky thing because it's not like emissions. If you burn something here, it affects the global atmosphere, and it doesn't matter where they're emitted. With water, it does. If you're in Norway, say, where water is absolutely abundant, that's one thing. That among the issues may be water quality. If you're in sub-Saharan Africa, or if you're in Chile, where there was a real problem with water permits that Barrick Gold, some of you may have heard of, they had to close an $8 billion mine because of the water issue. So these are serious and significant business issues. I looked at one of your previous talks, somebody was talking about deforestation as 25%, causing 25% of emissions. Now, the thing that I've used, is being conservative, is 15%. Doesn't really matter, it's a significant part. And whether it is cattle, timber, soya, or palm oil, all these are main drivers of deforestation. This change of land use is a vital driver of there. And these are world ubiquitous. They're in all the supply chains around the world, and we hardly know they're there. And again, by asking these questions, we're causing people to ask and to accredit where their products are coming from. And we're going to need to know that, or they're going to need to know that in the future as we are hitting the environmental boundaries of the planet. Cities programme. It's been going for a few years now. We've got 207 cities disclosing. And the Cities programme is an exception that proves the rule. There's no authority that asks cities to disclose, and yet the figure was 28% of global GDP is in those 207 cities, stretching from Tokyo through to Washington, Brasilia, Karachi, Cape Town. So it is a self-assessment tool, and this is one of the things we're talking about in communication, that by disclosing in a standardized process, you can actually compare what you're doing to others, learn from them, share best practice, and start taking account of what's going on. This is one of my favorites. This is the Climate Disclosure Standards Board, or CDSB, because we like acronyms. And this came out of the World Economic Forum in 2007. And the aim is to integrate climate change related information into mainstream corporate reports. So if you imagine you've got the financials at the back, you put the non-financials at the front, and you have to talk the right language. Now what was interesting, I had feedback from a finance director who, when asked to disclose about CDP, said, "I don't know what carbon is." And I took that really seriously, because how on earth does carbon fit in with, you know, the balance sheets and the profit and loss accounts? But this is working, the technical work group on this were the main accountants and the accountancy bodies, as well as experts in the field. So we can now put in climate change, and we're about to launch in June environmental information that can therefore be aligned and applied to financial information. So it complements CDP, and again it's a communication factor about communicating management assessment as well as connecting financial and non-financial information. We can't do this alone. We work with all these companies and organisations around the world. And one of the most important ones that I've also left off with is We Mean Business. And we're heavily engaged with them in the activities towards Paris in December, which is a vital time for us all. So, where possible, we work with these guys to keep ourselves aligned. And also, there's the CRD, which is the Corporate Reporting Dialogue. Now, that came out of the International Integrated Reporting Council. And they've just introduced a landscape map, which is a week is out, which looks and compares CDP's framework, CDSB, FASB, GRI, IASB, IRC, ISO, the International Standards Organization, and SASB from America, together to see where they overlap and how they connect together. So as I said, we are looking for ways to work together. Now that's a good start, and that's the CDP process. And I'm going to talk about just three initiatives which I think are very important, so it's a slightly different angle, that CDP are either working by themselves or in partnership. The first one is Carbon Action. This is an investor-led initiative, and it's a very simple one. On behalf of these guys, these investors, they select various companies as a the letter says, invites them to set targets, to commit to reduce their emissions, and to commit to putting emission reduction activities that have got a positive return on investment. Now, if you've done any business, you know any project with a positive net present value, you should be doing, because you're going to be making more money than not. So it's those three simple things that they're asking. And this, in conjunction with what CDP is doing, is again, it's another drive to action. So it's not just about getting information. This is a request, again, from shareholders to do something about what's going on. Science-based targets. Yesterday, we launched a tool that enables a business to put in some information and work out what their target should be, so that they can set a target in line with the climate science. That seemed incredibly obvious. We're talking about 2 degrees rise, 4 degrees rise, whatever, and carbon budgets. Of course we want targets set. It hasn't been done before. And when we talk about ideal universities, there's not a university there. They're just some organizations that have come together that have put their technical expertise in order to do this. I just want to do this to show roughly how it works, just a bit of background. You have a carbon, you have a 2 degrees limit that we want to try and reach or not to exceed, which gives you a global carbon budget from science. We can then separate that into the sectoral carbon budgets. We then need projections by activity, because it's difficult to translate emissions like that, but you can do tons of product or you can then get a sectoral intensity, and then you can work out where your company sits within that. So it's a relatively straightforward process, but again, it's quite complicated when you get down to the science. But I mean, that just gives me hope that we can actually start seeing what we're doing. A lot of big words here, so. Fiduciary duty. A fiduciary duty is a legal duty to act on solely in another's interests. And a lot of directors and other companies have used this as an excuse to avoid investing in emission reduction activities and take the climate change seriously. At last year's UMPI Academic Network, the winning paper was by Sarah Barker, and it was the director's duties in the Anthropocene, liability for corporate harm due to inaction on climate change. So the premise of the paper was that we have the major scientists in the world saying climate change is an issue. For a company not to take that to account is a breach of the fiduciary duties. Well, we'll see where that goes as far as the court cases. Stranded assets, I know people have talked about stranded assets in the past. And what that means is if you have a carbon budget of 2 degrees for the 2 degrees level, I think Carbon Tracker worked out that 80% of known reserves will have to stay in the ground and cannot be burnt. Now, whether you want to take that account or not, what you can say with a huge margin of error, if companies are investing in further exploration, then any shareholders can validly ask, why on earth are you spending that when what you've got already you can use? So that for me is a breach of fiduciary duty, if the question's not being asked. And it's a breach if companies are investing in that type of thing.
Could you say that last bit again? You dropped your voice, and it was particularly interesting, and I didn't know what you said. There's the percentage of the fossil fuels not to be used.
80%. Yes, in the ground. So the carbon tracker something that says to hit the 2 degree level, that 80% of known reserves would have to be kept in the ground. We can only burn 20% of that we know about. If you know that, you know, if the 20% margin is between 20 and 25, or even double it, 50, then it's still there. Why on earth are people still doing all their exploration in the Arctic and dust piles? That's really what it is. There may be very good reasons, backtracking fast, allegedly, and all that. And back to the CDSB statement. They issued a statement called Fiduciary Duty and Climate Change Disclosure that was signed by companies and investors. This was in the New York Climate Week, too, when Ban Ki-moon asked for his initiatives. And basically, I'll read it out. It's saying, it's asking, it's signing up to use CDSB's framework or similar to place climate-related information relevant to shareholder value in their mainstream corporate reports. It's as simple as that, it's back to the transparency issue, and it's still open for signatures now. And hopefully we'll have, at COP20, you know, this document will be much more robust and depending on the signatures. So, I've talked a bit about climate change, how complex that is. I've talked a bit about CDP and how we're doing our bit, working with partners in the outside world. And now I want to say that's only the tip of the iceberg. But I want to talk about the ideal university. The ideal university is an institution providing research and education. I just want to say that I'm well aware that I am in a university, And I'm well aware that even words like an institution are very fraught. I went up to my finance professor and was going to talk to him about CDP, about his business school signing up and getting involved. And he said, we're not an institution. In part, he meant that it wasn't called an institution as the ISR is, but he also meant that he was an academic that almost took for granted the institution, and he was interested in his own research and the research of his peers, which could have been other universities. And it really dawned on me the fractured nature of universities in general. So I'm trying to be as cautious as possible, as loose as possible, so that an institution finding new social attention. Let me just check in with UCL, as an ideal university. UCL's role and charter is to provide education and courses of study, to encourage research, and to organise, encourage, and stimulate postgraduate study. That looks like it's fine. Now, the international strategy adds to contribute to the resolution of problems of global significance and to contribute to UCL's financial stability. So let's just add that in. And we've got an institution and investor providing research and education, understanding and resolving global problems. That seems to be quite a nice fit. Now, if we want to bridge the gap, if we take CDP and its data, its process and what it's doing out in the economics of the world out there, and we take the ideal university, let's just have a look at where we are. We at the moment have researchers using CDP data. At the last count, over the last couple of years, I've looked at 200 papers who've used CDP data or referred to the CDP process. And they're in over 70 different journals. So it's happening now. And you can argue that a lot, argue that is minimal and should be up in the magnitude. As educators, we're involved in MSc programs, research. We've even developed some assignments with some universities about how to use CDP data. And one assignment was researching on behalf of the endowment fund and other universities in their city to go to non-disclosed CDP and justify why they should disclose. Again, that's taking information from the external world into the world of teaching. As investors, many universities, funnily enough, are signed up for endowments. But one university, I spoke to their treasurer, was insisted that their pension fund signed up as well. I'm not sure if UCL has signed up for the endowment, but I know their pension fund, under the superannuation scheme, is signed up. So again, that CDP is working on behalf of many, many universities around the world already. I put divest from fossil fuels, because I know that's contentious. Quite a lot of universities are divesting endowment funds. Quite a lot aren't, and quite a lot haven't even thought about it. But they could do. And as an institution, some universities are disclosing to CDP. I even had an inquiry the other day for somebody concerned, interested in the supply chain program of all the suppliers to a university, and how that could relate. Now that's a commercial exercise for us, and that's one of the things that keeps us going. And I know that most universities have got a carbon management plan. And in the UK, somebody said, why can't you set up a program for universities so that we've got an established way of reporting our emissions that we can compare and learn? I say, we haven't got the resources to do it yet, but anybody wants to talk about it, I'm really happy to talk about it. So we've got this connection already. This is a connection with what's going on in the outside world with the data. It's connecting to use the data with people who've got the time, the ability, the skills to actually take this forward. So I was almost going to stop from there, but there are some issues. How effective would this be if the ideal university used CDP data and, as I've said, in their curriculum? Would it really work? Is our existing thinking appropriate? I just like this quote because he's may be right, you may be wrong. Anyway, you cannot solve problems by using the same kind of thinking we use when recruiting. So if we take research, most research, the primary aim of that research is to get it published in peer-reviewed journals. And I realise that I'm absolutely a straw man about this, so you know, you'll have to take this with a bit of a pinch of salt, but take that as a premise. Now, what's happening, because these journals and these disciplines have been around for a while, is that the focus of research gets narrower and narrower and more specific, because most of the exciting research has already been done. And therefore the audience, even in the disciplines, is narrowing. And therefore, how can you expect that detailed research to be used elsewhere in other disciplines, especially when there are very few cross-discipline journals? I think it's a wonderful irony is that the disciplines had to be created to examine the world outside. It's so complex that you can't just do it all at once, you have to do that. On the other hand, when you've got that research, it needs to be pulled back together again in order to make sense of what's going on. So how can these conclusions be communicated? Not only within a discipline, but between disciplines. And even when you've got that, how do you communicate to the outside world? And somebody came up with the idea that every paper that's published should have a blog next to it of 300 words and signed off by the editor of the student magazine, just to make certain that it was written in plain English to be understood. And I'll leave that to you whether you think that's a good idea or not. On education, we know that education courses, by definition, really are based on past learning. Adding elements to courses is difficult because last year's work, so tomorrow's next year's. Cross-discipline courses are difficult to add, and obviously some are adding, but they have to replace other courses. And if we're about educating leaders tomorrow, we have to ask ourselves, do we want students to think for themselves, or do we want students to apply the thinking that the universities have actually given? Now this is an interesting thing, just to try and lighten the mood really, said this made the New York Times. The University of Wyoming's Art Museum commissioned Chris Drury to do a project, and he did a carbon sink, what goes around and comes around. Wyoming is very intensive into natural resources, and particularly coal. And because of the warming winters, the pine beetle has thrived. It used to die off in the winter, but it is now thriving. And vast stretches of forest are being destroyed in Wyoming, that beautiful state. There are pictures of pine trees on a bed of coal, and then being said, disappearing down a vortex. Now, this may have gone down well with the university students, but it did not go down well with the politicians and with the energy executives in the state. And I'll read the quote that one of them said. We need to educate some of the folks at the University of Wyoming about where their paychecks come from. They threatened to pull the funding if that artwork was removed. Now, whether or not you think that's an issue, for me, what is more of an issue is that universities are producing the, say, leaders of tomorrow, they're producing the workforce of tomorrow. If the workforce of tomorrow doesn't want this, doesn't want them to do climate change, doesn't want them to do sustainability, wants business to carry on as it is, then we've got a problem here. So even if all the students came out and they want to work in sustainability and make certain that we've got a planet for future generations, if their employees don't want it, there's a big problem here. So that's, again, why I think it is so important to start seeing how it all comes together, not just in isolated. I've often thought that just changing two letters in the word shareholders would make a huge difference. And it's, again, subtle change of perspective. If we start looking at shareholders and turning to stakeholders, we start looking at an interconnected system, start moving from single issues the systems, we start understanding what's going on and the ramifications of what we're doing. We can connect past and present in the accounts to the financing of the future. And as importantly, it's both and. So it's not just one paradigm or another, we have to look at this together. And I'm going off on a bit of a tangent now, so forgive me for this hearing me. Some of you may have read Thomas Kuhn's work in 1962, a very famous year, Rachel Carson wrote Silent Spring. If you haven't read it, it's a book that you should read. Wrote the Structure of Scientific Evolutions. And he starts off by talking about normal science, and that's the paradigm that we're all in, business as usual. Then come things that we're not really quite sure of, and we adapt that to normal science, we have anomalies. A crisis is reached. We have extreme events, we have complex problems, and I mentioned the anger of students. I think that's heading towards a crisis, when we actually wake up to what's going on. And if we don't wake up before Paris, then there will be a crisis. Now, that can lead to a paradigm change. I want to talk about stakeholder theory versus the theory of just as an example. I said to one professor who's going to the EU and talking about changing carbon accounting from scope to emissions. If a company outsources its emissions, its manufacturing, say to China, it loses its emissions. They go into scope three, it's nothing to do with it. He wants to change that theoretical framework and look at the stakeholder theory. And that would mean it doesn't matter where you operate, where you manufacture, it's all part of that process. Now that is just a change of paradigm. I think, simply speaking, that if we change the paradigm to look at a sustainable economy, then that would have more significance to the way we look at our research and the way we operate than the revolutionary theory of Copernicus. So, let's return to the practical steps of bridging the gap. I've covered what researchers can do, educators, investors, and institutions. And if that ideal university can simply communicate within and between disciplines and to the external stakeholders, that's the change that's needed. And I think that this is a simple step in the right direction that can make a huge, huge difference to communicate the amazing work that universities are doing with the work that's been done outside in the global economy, in the developed world, in the developing world, and it can bring it all together. So, thank you all. I applaud UCL for all its steps in the right direction of becoming an ideal university. And for all I know, they may already be there, but that's just my observations from this perspective.
Well, thank you very much, Patrick. And now we're going to have some questions about that great presentation. Lots of hands. Lady there, and then the gentleman who we know might come across.
Hi, my name is Navarro Sabio from UCL Energy Institute.
You'll have to speak up a bit, please.
Sorry, my name is Navarro from UCL Energy Institute. And I'm interested in the methodology that because you were mentioning the tool that you have just recently released about the science budgets, carbon budgets that you generate for companies. What's the allocation method that you use for the different?
I'm going to have to refer you to the website. It's called sciencebasedtargets.org. Because I heard today that it's been reduced from 180 pages down to 100 pages.
Okay.
So, but it's there on the website. But I think that the tool we use is simpler. And then there is an executive summary of a couple of pages. So that may be a useful starting point.
But do you use a modeling tool or is it just an accounting tool?
Do you know?
It's a modeling.
And does it take account of costs of abatement between the sectors?
I don't know.
I don't think so. I don't know.
Sounds like a joint project to me.
Right. Absolutely fine. Gentlemen there.
I'm very supportive of what you're trying to do. May I constructively make several points? First, I am a diversified private shareholder, reading a lot of company annual reports, particularly FTSE 100 companies, FTSE 250, and can report that many of them contain sections on greenhouse gas emissions. The trend is there. And I think we may suppose that they've realized if they're using less fuel, they're implicit in reducing their emissions, carbon emissions, it is saving cost and benefiting the business. So I would reassure you that that information is gathering momentum. As to a point about the extractive industry companies, like the oil majors and miners, I think, frankly, you have a problem there because they can all point to predictions of huge energy demand rise. And they understandably see their business as extracting hydrocarbons to meet that demand because alternative energy sources will not meet it. As to the miners, they are, in my experience, quite conscientious in what they do. They are themselves keen on reducing energy and carbon emissions, and as a sideline, they clean up after their activities. Another rather different point is that there is a move by government and other bodies to replace hydrocarbon consumption by alternative energy sources. The trouble is that many of them in present technology are relatively expensive. Onshore, offshore wind, biofuels, solar, all very expensive and arguably therefore not worth pursuing because they cost so much that the alternative energy, although it might give a nice warm feeling, I mean, I speak metaphorically, it might give a feeling of comfort, it's so expensive that it will still keep energy costs high. An overlooked opportunity, in my opinion, is nuclear, which has an enormous capital cost, which is thereafter relatively cheap. Our near neighbour France has, I think, 69 nuclear power stations meeting 80% of demand. Most of the rest comes from hydroelectric, which perhaps we can't match. We're fiddling around replacing the odd one here and there, having sold British energy to the French. And it seems to me there should be a strange thrust on government to replace and multiply nuclear generation in this country.
Okay, I think it's time to ask our speaker to respond and then to move on to a few other comments. Thank you very much indeed.
Okay, I think you're right that the main companies are, I think 90% of the FTSE 100 exposed to CDP. I think, you know, there's one investor saying that most emissions are connected to energy. If you reduce energy, you save money and you save emissions, and if you save money, my share price goes up. Why would you? So a lot of that is actually fine. What I was trying to do is not get into that detail, because I think that why I said it's a necessary solution is what CP is doing and the universities are doing is to set the context to exactly how to have those discussions. If we change that paradigm to say we're going to look to the future and we've got this carbon budget, that's all we can do, then do we want to spend all that now, knowing that we're going to leave, you know, exceed that budget, and therefore we're going to leave future generations in the trouble that's been forecast. So I don't know, and I know some very deep green ecologists who say, yes, I think nuclear is the right way to go. And others will say, no, because of fusion of the reasons, you know, that it's not. So the point is that we've got to ask ourselves, how are we going to get through this? And if we ask that question, it's not just about a few efficiency savings here and about what's keeping the lights on. Although those are important questions that have to be addressed. But that's why, if you've got this framework, you can start addressing it.
Thank you. Gentlemen there. We'll come to the front.
Michael Grubb, half-time professor here at ISR. Also, perhaps most relevant, also editor-in-chief of the Private Policy Journal. Maybe just say there are lots of forums that UCL hosts where one can debate the relative costs of different technologies, etc. I'm not sure this is the best forum within which to pursue that one, so I was going to ask something completely different. There's an old saying that what you can't measure, you can't manage. You've talked about the interface between academia and identified the process of digging deeper, and its relation to disciplinary specialisation and journals. And I've never forgotten a comment that the executive editor that I hired to run the journal said, you know, the real problem here is that the impact factor measures the exact opposite of impact in the real world. Because what it measures is an article saying something methodologically new and interesting that lots of other articles need to cross-refer to, which is not what policymakers or businesses actually need to read about. What they need to know is what conclusions does this generate once it's matured, etc., etc. And it is a real problem because academics have to track largely their KPI is citation journals. And speaking as editor of the journal, this is an interminable problem to which the only solution I can see is if somewhere, somebody, delighted to discover it exists, but not found it, has something which is a policy impact factor. Now, we can't do that, it would be terribly self-serving. Right? You need actually an institution outside of any individual journal, publisher, or even university to develop what would really be a decent measure of relevant, policy relevant research in the climate change or environmental policy sphere. And I just wondered, have you heard of anything, and is that something CDP could consider?
I haven't heard. I think that's really interesting because obviously policy relates to politicians and the voters and the governments, etc., i.e. the outside world, and that would just seem to be an obvious natural link. And in an ironical sort of way, when I mentioned about blogs, it's sort of how to take that information out and translate it into useful information. I think all I would say on that is that if I could articulate a question, I would want universities to address it. That's what universities are good at, taking these questions.
Okay. Universities are good. Disciplinary-based research is either pursuing the frontiers of knowledge built upon previous academic inquiry, not at answering other people's practical applied questions. That's taking people away from what they're being paid for and what their metrics measure.
Correct. That's what they're doing, but therefore we start having to question the metrics.
Okay, let's move further to the front. I've got a number of comments.
Andrew Ross from Global Garden. I think you're massively underselling yourself. The achievements of CDP are colossal. You have triggered investor demand globally into inquiry into what are essentially externalities and how they can be accounted for. Now, the scale of this is an accounting problem that is a truly cross-disciplinary methodological problem. And in this arena, the Natural Capital Committee, under Professor Peter Helm, which has got the support of this government, now the re-elected Tory government, through Oliver Letwin, onto the Economic Affairs Committee, and thereby across government, is making great progress in formalising natural capital accounting in the national accounts under the Office for National Statistics and incorporating landscape scale project decisions as part of ordinary economics. Now, the opportunity surely here is for universities to look at natural capital accounting as the cross-disciplinary discipline itself, because that covers biology and geology and accounting and politics and economics and investment banking. It's the set. Now there's the opportunity, surely, to bring all of this together in one really attractive and relatively simple, in quotes, way of presenting this as a popular course for students.
Well, that's a great idea. But I also think to add to that, I mentioned about CDSB, the Climate Disclosure Standards Board, having that environmental information, okay, water and forest, but therefore applicable to other environmental, natural capital issues, can bring that together with the financial account and therefore can be usable. So that's an enablement. And it's already accredited for the changes to the UK Companies Act last year, the year before, that using the CDSB framework is a means of compliance with that. So thank you, that's a long right track. So if we take that on board with suitable universities.
Well, there's huge demand. You see, the green bond market is booming, heading for 100 billion this year, and you can't find the projects. And they also need the analysts to go out and invite companies to apply for this incredibly cheap money. There's no problem with the money. It's the knowledge and the expertise in companies to wise up and get investment.
Okay, Chairman, looking forward to
briefly comment on some figures. First, 2 degrees centigrade rise, you said, scientists. I understood this is not so. I understood it was the politicians' compromise, and the scientists wanted something about half that with much less risk. But I have two other points. So, Professor here, we made a number of very strong points about how expensive renewables are. I don't have your name, I'm sorry. Could I comment that on The Guardian on Monday, fossil fuels, which you are comparing, presumably the cost of energy from renewables with the cost of energy with fossil fuels, they had a figure of the subsidy to fossil fuels is $27 trillion a year. I may have my figure slightly wrong.
Okay, but well, this, I think Michael this, said this, includes, this wasn't where we were going to debate this, if you don't mind. Yeah. I'm up with these costs as well. I quite agree that some of the statements here were controversial and I would want to contest them too, but I want to keep the focus on what we have our speaker here tonight, because we won't have him here any time again soon, probably, because he's busy. Do you have a question to him about the particular subjects that he's talking about?
I'll leave others to
indeed, and indeed you can have a bilateral upstairs over a glass of wine. I'm sure that would be fascinating. I've got a question for you, which is about the power of information, or perhaps its lack of power, and I'd just like you to comment on that. When the UCL Green Economy Policy Commission reported last year, information was indeed one of the key topics. We did have a box about CDP and the work that you're doing, but there's a lot of academic study that suggests that information by itself is not going to provide the impetus that is required, because people have lots of reasons for ignoring inconvenient information. Indeed, you showed Al Gore's thing about the global warming, but the title of his book, of course, was Inconvenient Truth. That was the main title. So, and there are lots of defense mechanisms against inconvenient information, and indeed some pretty crude ones, such as the paymasters of Wyoming University. That information is inconvenient for them. So, and I just wondered whether you had thought beyond the very useful work you do in supplying information, which, as our friend here has said, can be expanded into natural capital accounting much more generally. And we do a fair bit of that too here at UCL ISR. But what else do you need, and what else will you need in order to overcome what in another project we're calling the web of constraints against that information having the impact which it might have. So think for us a bit beyond information that might actually get some of these actions going ahead.
It's a very complicated subject. If you just look at the supply chain, the supply chain members have normally got it, i.e. they're looking at their energy consumption, they've got training programs in place, their suppliers have it in general. They score about half. So one of the things CDP does is we score a response about how people are engaged with it. So what it really means is that most of these businesses are on this fabled journey. Some people deny it. Some people just do things out of compliance. Then some people are looking at just for operating efficiencies. And some people say, I'm going to make myself into a sustainable organization, and I'm going to be here for the long term, and this is how I'm going to change. I'm going to invest in my project that's got a 17-year return period rather than the three-year normal, because I want to have a renewable energy work for the long term and go do that. So this is why it's multifaceted, and it's not just a thing, it's not just one thing. So my point is, as people see that what leaders are doing, they say, oh, I could do that too, their share price hasn't changed at all, even though they've made those investments. You start sharing the best practice, they can start moving that mindset set forwards. The other thing about scoring is that I've got my phone just CDP climate change, is one of those Google alert things. When we have the scores, and people are awarded the climate exposure leaders index or performance index, I get press release after press release about X companies that is proud to be part of the index. And by that I mean is that they want their customers, their other shareholders, their other stakeholders to be involved. So it's brand value, it's brand reputation, it's how to engage with customers. So it's all these different elements and facings on one particular action that's been happening that is going to be the only answer, rather than just having information as the main thing.
That does indeed. Thank you very much, Patrick. I think, in fact, that's a very good point on which to end the formal proceedings this evening. Thank you very much for coming and sharing this fantastic work. I fully agree with what Andrew Ross said about the importance of the work that you have triggered here and its potential application. So thank you very much for coming and sharing all this.